President, Rector, honourable guests, Gwynedd Cor, students. First of all, may I once again say how grateful I am for the very warm welcome that my wife Sabina and I and those who are accompanying me, including the Minister for European Affairs, have received since I arrived in Croatia. And very particularly, it's a great pleasure to be, it's always a general pleasure to be in a university. It reminds me of my previous life, and particularly I thank you for the welcome to the University of Zagreb, the oldest university in Croatia, and also the oldest university in Southeast Europe, dating back to the mid-17th century. I congratulate you on that university tradition. I'm very pleased also to meet former students, current students, and members of staff, people who are engaging with the intellectual work that is so necessary, upon which so much democracy depends at the present time. I was impressed in preparing for this address to read that you educate 70,000, or almost half of all third-level students in Croatia, and the huge number of 5,000 academic staff, and a huge, and practically 78% of all the PhD graduate students at Croatian universities. I'm very pleased as President of Ireland and as a poet as well to know that the English Department of Faculty in Humanities and Social Sciences is very active, and that there are Irish studies is being taught under the care of Dr. Aidan O'Malley. But I thank all of you as well for honouring me with your presence today. And I have chosen in my address to look to think about the theme of the future of Europe, and to look at it through the prism of Croatia's accession to the European Union, the lessons that we have learned in Ireland after four decades of membership, and the challenges we will face together as partners in the cause of achieving the best future for our citizens. Very shortly, on July the 1st, Croatia will join the family of members of the European Union as a full member. Ireland has been a member of the European Union for just 40 years, and it has been, indeed, this government, previous governments, the current minister is very much a supporter of EU enlargement, and they are waiting and with great celebration will welcome Croatia with warmth on the 1st of July. The arrival of a new member is an opportune time, of course, both to reflect on how the Union came into being, to reflect on the vision of the founders of the Union, their values and hopes, and also on the future of the Union as a part of an ever more interdependent global community. A community that is interdependent not only in terms of its commerce and economics ever more so, but also interdependent on its vulnerabilities. And these challenges will have to be faced, if to be faced sustainably and successfully, through international cooperation and through institutions that are purposeful and effective, participatory and democratic. So the European Union, while drawing on its founding values and building on its achievements, is an unfinished project. Its relationship to the global community is one which is open to the influence of the culture and the experience of all of its members, founding and new. So Croatia, having made its way for more than a decade through 35 chapters of acquis and so forth, makes its contribution as we look at the form of the European Union that might adequately engage with such a significant series of global challenges. The space that is the European Union is within which one can envisage a future, depart from old conflicts. And in dealing with old conflicts, as we in Ireland have learned, create such an amnesty of memory on old conflicts and with old protagonists as will enable a shared future to be constructed that is to the benefit of both and beyond. The road that your country has traveled since applying for membership in 2003 has been a long one, and I suppose for many involved in the process it may no doubt have often seemed arduous, perhaps at times unending. At any event, our journey now ends, and we in Ireland hope that the Croatian people, and it is our wish individually and collectively, will benefit from the new prospects for greater stability and prosperity that membership will hopefully confer. In our own language, may I say, Guim Gokra, Gaspanak, Agus Gokra, Gokra, the Megar Shulam, Winter Croatia, Suntaki, is the Sneglunta Tolichia. We in Ireland will remain interested in hearing of and sharing in your achievements, and we look forward to cooperating with you in every way in creating an inclusive, sustainable, and above all, cohesive future for the Union whose membership we together will share. You remember your journey over those years? It has been challenging. Aspiring member states are required to undergo a rigorous process of change, including assurances as to the stability and sustainability of democratic institutions, the rule of law, human rights, as the founding treaties indeed require, as well as a functioning market economy, which the politics of the Copenhagen principles seek. The debate you will participate in now as full members may well be one that concentrates to an even more urgent degree on such forms of social economy as can adequately address the challenges of unemployment, the increasing threat of poverty, and issues of inequality within the Union. The European Union is both, of course, a political union and an economic union. It is a union that is not without its problems, as I have said, 26 million unemployed, 5.7 million who are young unemployed, 135 million threatened with poverty. And some of those problems, in fact, have come from outside. Others have been created within the union. Some have come from the international consequences of deregulation in ever more speculative and unaccountable markets. Others have come, in the Irish case, from perhaps our own sources, in relation to property bubbles, for example. The blight of unemployment, as I've said, particularly youth unemployment, which is at an alarming level in member states, is without doubt, I suggest, the greatest challenge. It is because it carries with it, if neglected, if allowed to abjure, a danger of delegitimizing democratic institutions themselves. But let us not forget one fundamental point that has not changed, that is at the very heart of this European Union, our union, and it is first and foremost a union of values. And those values were put into the founding treaties as values for the benefit into the future of all citizens. Their evolution, too, must be for the value of all citizens within our common European space. The founders of the European Union, recognizing the appalling cost of war, they saw the value of peaceful cooperation. From working together, they saw that they could build a future on shared values. It was not simply to turn one's back on the enormous savagery of war, but also to create an alternative through peace. And the values upon which the Union is founded set out, for example, in such articles as Article 2 of the Treaty on the European Union, values that stress human dignity, freedom, democracy, equality, the rule of law, and respect for human rights, including the rights of persons belonging to minorities. And these are powerful and compelling, and carry an ethical demand with them. They are wide-ranging, and they are not narrow, nor are they simply economic. Such values are essential to achieving not only a just society, but a flourishing society, whether that society is confined by national borders, and this is achieved within national borders, or whether it is achieved for 500 million people that form the society that is the European Union. Values provide the bedrock of the Union itself, irrespective of whatever economic, political, or environmental challenges present themselves. They must remain at the heart of the Union, the prism through which policies are established, if the Union is to remain true to the vision and aspirations of not just its founding fathers, but that which most people wanted from the Union when they gave their assent to membership. I think as well for it to provide a space for regional adjustment, for ridding Europe of old enmities that dominated much of the last century, enmities between and within nations and peoples, including in my own country. As societies emerge from conflict, dealing with the painful legacies of the past is never easy, especially where those memories are contested. I have in my own presentations on this topic or in recent years been very much influenced by work of the French philosopher, the late Paul Ricoeur, and his writings on the ethics and politics of memory. Dealing with conflicts, no one is required to invent a bogus amnesia, nor would it be helpful. Only to consider, as I have already said, the value of an amnesty in memory, such as would enable one to put one's narrative side by side with others, to put oneself in the place of the other, so as to achieve, as it were, such a situation as would enable one to maybe review, revise, and then live in peace and flourish together in a shared future, in a confident, safe present, no longer threatened by the past. We look to brighter days for Europe as the family of nations becomes 28 on the 1st of July. And we look to Croatia to offer guidance and assistance to its Balkan neighbors with the accession process. Croatia has already generously provided a lead with its translation made available to other potential applicants, its translation of the European acquis. Making that translation available for neighboring applicants was a very significant, generous gesture to regional cooperation. And in the process, it has helped not only all those who favor enlargement across the Union, but it has helped the Union itself. And Ireland, as a constant supporter of enlargement, notes it with particular pleasure. The Croatia that will join the European Union, of course, as a full member on the 1st of July, has changed in many ways over the past 10 years, and it is set to change again in the years ahead. As will the European Union. Real and startling change at international level has taken place over the last decade, and it continues at a rapid pace. In the world of business, Croatian companies are now better prepared for full participation in an internal market with direct access to over 500 million people, offering potential for more jobs and better living standards. Croatian citizens will enjoy greater possibilities to study and work in the European Union. And I am delighted that Ireland is playing its part, as the Irish government has committed to allow full access for Croatian people to our labour market. But in addition to these domestic benefits, I believe that your successful completion of accession negotiations will send broader positive signals to the whole of the Western Balkans region, namely that the European Union delivers on its commitments undertaken in relation to enlargement within the Union itself. The message is that its enlargement policy remains an effective and transformative tool in promoting a greater political stability and creating new economic opportunities for the world. Croatian accession affirms that the European Union is a formidable political force based on values, as well as being a competitive, and I stress again, cohesive entity in a globalized age. Croatia was faced with the task of building a sovereign state. But I think perhaps I suggest that holding the aspiration of achieving full European Union membership, that state had to be built on the common values that the European Union represents, to which I've referred, and I have no doubt that aspiring towards full membership of the European Union may have been a significant force for good in that regard, providing a fixed point on the horizon to guide your efforts, offering advice and support in reaching your goals, goals that you have chosen as a benefit to your own people now and on into the future. So Croatia has walked that path towards the full European membership for more than a decade and has been deeply engaged with the Union through the accession process. Yet I suppose it is worth reflecting on the question as to why public support for European Union membership is, in some circles, apparently still tentative here. Is it that Croatian citizens feel removed from the process within the European Union, unable to fully accept that European Union membership can be of benefit to their lives and the futures of their children? These are legitimate questions at any endpoint of such a significant transition. They are perfectly democratic and reasonable questions. The decision to share sovereignty comes very soon after its acquisition. This pursuit of understanding a complex process of pooled sovereignty and a perception of blocks to full participation in decision-making, I assure you, is not confined, nor has it been historically, to Croatian citizens. In this year, the year the Europe has decided to call the European Year of Citizens, we are all challenged by the knowledge that so many people throughout member states feel more and more disconnected, feel that they're not participating in the decision-making of an economic kind that shapes and governs our lives. Speculative markets, even rating agencies, appear at times to be more frequently quoted as the source of ultimate, even enforced, decision-making as to economic options for the future, rather than the elected parliaments. It is to parliaments, though, however, all of us who've spent all our lives in democracy, it is to parliament citizens look for the expression of the debate and the articulation of the choice of options which might be made available in public policy. It is something that must give us all cause for concern as leaders, and insofar as I am speaking in a university, public intellectuals are called to become now engaged in these issues. It is, after all, of the very essence of democracy, that which is accountable, that which is representative. I cannot in a short paper, but I have in other papers in Europe spoken about the difference, as it were, between those who come through an elective process and those who take part and offer their options, sometimes winning, sometimes by consensus agreeing with others, whatever, and that which is totally unaccountable. I have, and it is for another day, and it is particularly for those who are economists among you, and those who might be interested in political economy, to consider what has happened in economic theory. After all, standing behind any form of political, or any form of option in economics, it stands policy. And stands behind policy stand intellectual institutions. And mainly my case has been essentially, since I became president, making the case for the plurality of intellectual opinion, rather separate would relate it to the issue I have mentioned earlier, which those of you who are interested in fiscal economics particularly can trace, as to what happens after the Glass-Steagall Act is amended, as rating agencies both underwrite and evaluate products that are derivatives as they travel around the world, and then as rating agencies change their relationships to peoples and so forth. It's a good subject for discussion in any university at any time. And those of us who are somewhat, if you like, from the classical tradition, who believe in fiscal economics, have a humble opinion. And that is that fiscal economic measures are a necessary but not a sufficient strategy in dealing with the problems of Europe. Returning to my paper, I put these pieces in just to keep people excited who travel with me from home. I have to say, when I spoke in the European Parliament, I spoke of an unconscious drift to disharmony, of a loss of social cohesion, of the dangers if you allowed unemployment to continue heavily localized and obduring, that might lead, in fact, to not only disharmony, but a recurrence of racism and even a continuing erosion or a deficit of democratic accountability. These are issues we cannot afford to ignore, to hide from, however uncomfortable acknowledging them might be. We have a duty to confront them if we are to stay true to the values on which the unity of Europe has been built. And if the European Union that is to make a contribution to global challenges is to emerge, we have to achieve such a discourse as puts the values of the Union, its cohesive ambition as a union, at the top of our mutual agenda. And in the face of deep economic challenges, we need to hold fast to the idea of a human Europe, one that esteems the personal and celebrates the human spirit and achievement. After all, artists and writers and poets and those who are interested in music have not known borders and have been able to transcend conflicts. We need that union. Yes, we need to be efficient, but not as a substitute to our human Europe, a dry technocratic order with a very limited moral or intellectual base. We need a Europe that, in responding to economic challenges, is conscious of the social consequences of its policies and actions. We need a Europe that shows solidarity with the most vulnerable among us, that throws real energy and determination behind efforts to create the real sustainable growth that is intergenerationally just and that will give us the jobs that are vital. This is what the Irish presidency, I believe, for the last 6 months has been taking as its motivation. And if we are to do this, we must draw on all the inherited wisdom of our past, our imaginative versions of a future flourishing life together. And to need this, to do this, we mustn't rely simply on narrow disciplines. We need interdisciplinary scholarship that will lead to a pluralism of policies that can be put in an engaging democratic way to our peoples. We need to remember that we do not exist in the abstract theoretical world, as I've said, of speculative markets that determine value and apportion wealth. Rather, we live in the real world of flesh and blood people with the real needs and real contributions to make. And the Union, after all, draws its legitimacy from the support of its people. I've said recently in the European Parliament in Strasbourg, we cannot allow a crisis in a single paradigm of economics to lead to a crisis of political legitimacy. We must believe and we must have confidence in our intellectual capacities to bring into being such a suite of proposals, macro and micro in their economic scope, that will serve as effective instruments for our political and social purposes. We need a pluralism of policies based on all of our disciplines in the inherited tradition and in the imaginative capacity of all our Europeans. So I repeat again that our union is fundamentally founded on these values of personal dignity, freedom, democracy, equality, and the rule of law, and respect for human rights. And they must now give us strength as we face some testing times. They must be the yardsticks against which we must measure everything we do. And they are values by which we must chart our course in our dealings with the peoples of our neighborhood and our world. Croatians and their neighbors quite rightly see themselves as Europeans from ancient times. And even if new members of the European Union, they are new members who share these values I speak of and seek to uphold them. And the question remains then, why is there an apparent lack of enthusiasm in some sectors to join a union founded on these values I mention? It is not for me to hypothesize as to the motivation of the Croatian people or any of its neighbors, but I can offer some reflections drawn from our experience in Ireland and those of our existing European partners. I think one concern held by many entrants is the fear that European Union membership might actually result in a worsening of their economic situation. The fear, for example, that Croatians might end up paying European Union prices while living on Croatian salaries. There are concerns about cuts in subsidies, maybe, or maybe in state supports. Many other European nations have shared similar worries prior to joining the European Union. However, what does experience tell us? It tells us that the biggest beneficiaries of the last enlargement of the Union were the 12 new member states. The accession process boosted economic growth in the new member states by an average of 1.75% per year between the period 2000 and 2008. Living standards rose, incomes increased, and unemployment declined. But the Union, of course, is not immune from global challenges, and neither is there a single version of the political context in which economic paradigms are chosen. As the pendulum has swung in political choices, so has the economic policy swung from modified Keynesianism in some decades to lightly regulated speculative markets in others. And the pendulum swings again. With elections all over Europe, it can swing again in any other direction. That is democracy. So in economic theory, change is also taking place. Neo-institutionalists are now successfully challenging neoliberals and order liberals within the neoclassical school. And as to Ireland itself, my country has witnessed a transformation over the past 40 years. In 1973, Irish GDP was 60% of the European average. Then we were the poorest among the 9 member states. Now, notwithstanding our current difficulties, our GDP is well above the European average. We were then a country of structural immigration. It has returned, yes, but now with a more educated population. Our foreign trade in 1973, 55% of our exports went to the United Kingdom. And even though our trade with Britain has grown manifold as a proportion, it is now 17% of our exports. It provided us with a market that was different from a market with low food prices, and so forth. Our external trade is much larger, more diversified, and more balanced, accounting for over 90 billion. That is, and it is very important that now in our present difficulties, it is leading our economic recovery. I think our agricultural sector benefited enormously from a single market of 500 people. Also, as well as that, socially, things happened differently. In 1973, 4% of Irish students went on to third level education. Last year's figures in Ireland shows that 48% of the population between the ages of 25 and 34 had third level education. And I have to say as well that that is one of the principal features in attracting foreign direct investment to Ireland. It shows up in one location of industry study after another. We have also the highest proportion of students in the existing 27 completing second level education. So I think as well that even as speaking within an institution of learning. For example, there were changes in the challenges that were taken up by our third level institutions. Some are ranked in the top 5% globally. And I think as well it's very interesting that the International Student Barometer ranks Ireland ahead of all other English-speaking countries and Germany and Sweden and the Netherlands for international student satisfaction. In the summertime in Dublin, people, there are 70,000 third level students and 100,000 students come to learn English. And the same is true of many of the Irish cities. I think these aspects of education, social environment, flexibility, friendliness, humour, they're mentioned in academic work, as I've said, as key influencing factors in foreign direct investment. And I think that foreign direct investment has been a significant factor in our economic development as a country. But so also, and it was very significant, and I was a member of a cabinet that used it even in the cultural industries, was infrastructural assistance that we had structural funding from the European Union, allowing us to invest not only in our physical infrastructure, but in our social infrastructure. And there were social benefits too. Our attitude towards equality, towards the right of women to the same wages as men, I think this was powerfully assisted by our membership of the European Union. And I think as well, when one thinks of it in this way, yes, at the moment another feature that Ireland shares with Croatia is the number of our people who live outside of our borders, our diaspora. I think in many cases, the benefits of those who participated in an Ireland that had drawn on all of what I have spoken about, they've gone on to make a contribution outside of our borders. But I think in coming to the present and towards the end of what I have to say, I think that today the European Union has been dominated by narratives of high unemployment, underperforming economies and a currency under pressure. I believe myself that these are solvable problems, but that they are solvable problems only in terms of we've been committed to a kind of scholarship that stands behind policies and a scholarship that is drawing on pluralist sources, that enables a pluralism of policies. Yes, indeed, there are great and good initiatives of the micro kind now initiated by Ireland, such as the Youth Guarantee. And it is certainly my hope that it will speedily come to the assistance of young unemployed people when agreement on the budget is reached. But also there is need for macro policies that are sufficiently informed by such a pluralism of scholarship as will enable all options to emerge. I think that in Ireland, we took the view at an early stage that the path to recovery was nationally and for Europe was one that involved a stabilization of the currency. But more is required. We recognize the need for greater solidarity and deeper integration with the Union. And this is the path that has been followed. And we stress in the Irish discourse an importance to something that enjoyed parity of esteem at the time, for example, of the Lisbon Treaty. And that is the word cohesion. A union is a union when it is respecting cohesion. And together with our European partners and others, we've sought to strengthen the rules underpinning the euro, the ability to enforce them towards integration and banking, towards greater accountability. But as I've said, stability is not enough. I could not stress sufficiently the importance of being able to deal comprehensively with the notion of work in the community and with unemployment. Too many Europeans are without jobs. Too many Europeans feel that they are without prospects. And that was why Ireland's sponsorship of the Youth Guarantee being adopted by the Union was terribly important. But as I said, it needs to be accompanied by other measures now, which will create, for example, credit streams for the development of the real economy, including small and medium and new industries. And I think we as academics are challenged about something else. It is how we define employment and work. What are we to regard as work? What of those who are working in the social sphere, those who are working in volunteering, and so forth? That is why we have important work to do in moving ahead beyond financial reform, including banking union. And I therefore, the Irish presidency gave us the title for its agenda, Stability, Jobs and Growth. I think that the recent report of the European Commission on Employment and Social Situation is a description of what the European Union would wish to be in 2020. But it is in the current political realm and the public discourse now that the options must be debated and chosen. That is why it's not an abstract word. We need a discourse that is inclusive and various. We've learned in Ireland from historical experience that our economy and society, and this was the answer to the rhetorical questions I posed, we have learned that we have gained and prospered since we opened up to the world. We are today one of the most globalized economies in the world. And I think that Ireland's membership of the European Union has weathered the storms of recent years. And similarly, we in Ireland hope that Croatia's membership of the Union will enhance your capacity to address current economic challenges and enhance the prospects for all of the Croatian people. So let us agree that the European Union is not just an economic union. And when discussing and assessing the challenges facing the Union and the benefits that membership can bring, it's important to keep a big picture and a declared future in mind. The European Union is, after all, the most successful, let's be positive, the most successful peace process that the world has ever seen. I think that Robert Schuman's vision was of a supranational community that would share strategic resources in order, as he put it, not only to make war not only unthinkable, but materially impossible, and to build a lasting peace in Europe. And that was why the European Union was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize, saying for the prize going to those who shall have done the best work for fraternity among nations, for the abolition or reduction of standing armies, and for the holding and promotion of peace congresses. Now I think myself, I come from a country where a civil war politics dominated for decades and dominated in a negative way. Past grievances often deflected our energy and efforts from what we might have been achieving for our people at a social level. But I say this, facing up to the legacies of the past, finding ways to build a shared future, these are critical to ensuring stability and lasting peace. And while Croatia is the first of the Western Balkan states to accede, the others have all been given a European perspective. And for Ireland, European Union membership has allowed us and our neighbours to place our history in a wider context. Ireland and Great Britain, common membership of the European Union as equals, gave us a space for cooperation. And it is very apt that we both joined on the same day. And since then, the relationship between our countries has matured and strengthened into a partnership based on recognition and pursuit of shared but occasionally different objectives with mutual respect and with deep friendship. So therefore, I do not believe that so much could have been achieved without our membership of the Union. I firmly believe that this national experience of ours gives a great example of how the heavy burdens of history, which can seem unbearable on whom they most directly weigh, can be transcended through interaction in a wider context and framework. And this speaks to the importance both of regional cooperation in the Balkans and of the shared destiny and perspective of all countries in the region within the European Union. The European Union will be at its best when it embraces diversity, socially, intellectually, economically, when it can provide a platform on which to build a mature, strong relationship that acknowledges the past while recognizing, above all, the rich promise of a shared future. To conclude, let me say again, a generous vision of Europe is one that contributes most at home and abroad Europe has been and must remain a beacon of peace and democracy. It must encourage, it must lead, speaking with a unified voice on such common issues as climate change, poverty, on development, recognizing that those least contributing to our shared problems should not be asked to pay the highest price. Europe is already the largest donor in the fight against hunger and in efforts to scale up nutrition. And Ireland is happy to be giving a lead in that case about scaling up nutrition. And this is something upon which we can build together. How we deal with such global challenges is a major test of the future and of the authority and the credibility of the European Union in the present. It's one we cannot fail. So despite the economic challenges, we as member states individually, we must reaffirm the generous idealism that lies at the heart of the collective European vision, placing ourselves at the service of our citizens and those who strive daily for peace, justice, and human rights around the world. And the moral voice, I believe, of the European Union will be all the stronger after the 1st of July, when Croatia becomes our new partner. And I look forward as President of Ireland to that partnership. And I congratulate Croatia on becoming the 28th member of the Union. Karamila Mahagi, thank you.